Now it's a true joy to be speaking with Midjour. Thanks so much for joining me on the show.
That's a pleasure.
Why did you decide this was the year to release a completely new album?
Well, before it became a posthumous album, it was time to get it finished. I went through over the 10, 11 years since my last new music album. I went through a lot of phases of working on it and not working on it and thinking that I couldn't write any songs anymore, and then, thinking, well, maybe I can write songs, but maybe nobody wants to hear them. Do I want to be part of the music industry as it stands right now, because it's changed so much over the years? Mm. And then I kind of got my act together and just thought, you know what, finish what you're doing. You can't compete against what you might consider, a lot of as, mediocre. Mm-hmm. If you just hold your hands up and run away from it. So the only way you can compete is to go out there and make something that you think is interesting, that you think the music industry needs more of. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what I did. So this year, 3 months ago, I hadn't planned on finishing it yet, but I finished it all quite quickly, and I'm very pleased with the results.
Yes, fantastic. I'm so glad you did. I'm so glad you went ahead with it, because I know millions of fans are going to be so excited by it.
Well, the thing is, everything's changed since the last time I put a new album out, because, you get instant feedback from people on, Facebook and Twitter and all the social media things. So, the buzz that's going around about the album right now is fantastic. It's really good, because people don't just soft soap you, they let you know in no uncertain terms, whether they like something or not, be it a concert or a performance or a TV show or something you've said in the papers or whatever, they'll let you know instantly. Yes. But the feedback on the album has been fabulous.
Oh yeah, I mean, it's a wonderful album, I love it. I mean, despite some collaborations with Moby, this really is what could be termed a completely solo album. I mean, insofar as you've produced, you've engineered, you've arranged and played almost everything in the studio. Is this the first time you've ever done all that with one album, and how did it feel to do that?
It's the first time I've done it to this level. Literally it was me in the studio. There was no one else. I had no engineer, no producer, no sidekick, no real other musicians. In fact, no other musicians were in the studio. The only people who appear on that, there's a drummer who appears on one track who sent me a drum loop that he recorded at his home. Mm-hmm. And of course the track that I collaborated with Moby on, where he sent me a track from his then home in New York that he had recorded, and I kind of put it into my system and added to it and chopped it up and did all of that. So nobody actually appeared in my studio at all, so it really was an insular process. But I've never done it to that extent with previous albums. I've done a lot of things before, but there's always been someone else around that you can gauge, by their feedback as to whether what you're doing is any good or not.
Yes. Did you find that quite freeing, or did you feel a little bit sort of like, oh, I wonder how it's going to be received in the end?
A bit of both. Mm. I quite enjoyed the process of doing it in this kind of blinkered fashion, because I decided that when I was making this album, because of where I was and what I was doing and what was going on in my life, that I should be absolutely honest and brutally real about writing, about what I was saying in the songs, and when you do that, you have to be in a kind of insular place. It's very difficult singing or saying something or trying to, trying to evoke a certain emotion when you've got half a dozen people all sitting looking at you. Yeah. I suppose it must be like an actor, doing a sex scene in a movie. It's meant to be intimate and all of that. And of course, there's 20 people holding lights and pointing cameras at you. Yeah. It's a very difficult thing to do. So to do it properly, I thought, I've got to be completely on my own.
Mm, you've got to be within yourself and then
out
of yourself afterwards. Yeah. I mean, would you say that this album sort of been influenced in some way by your excellent work with Visage, Ultravox, Rich Kids and Thin Lizzy?
I think there's no doubt that all of that stuff comes out in what you do, because we all are the culmination of our influences, of what we experience and what we read and what movies we see and what people we meet and little bits of knowledge and little bits of melody and stuff that come and stick with us, because we're all born like sponges. We all go through life hearing something, seeing something, reading something that only you have read. And by the time you get to create your own thing, by the time you get to do your own output, you know, you've absorbed a different amounts of those things, but different from everybody else.
Yes.
So it makes you the individual you are. So when it comes to making an album, I'm 60 years old now, and it comes to making an album like Fragile,
yeah.
I can hear and see influences that I've had for 40 years, or 50 years, you know, all the way through this music. Maybe it might not be predominant to everybody else, but to me it's there. You know, I can hear bits of the British blues boom, I can hear bits of Thin Lizzy, certainly the guitar playing, and, you know, I can hear the textures and ambience of, you know, Brian Eno or Roxy Music or David Bowie, or, you know, all of that stuff all kind of permeates through what you do, and that's what makes you an individual. Having said that, if you played a track on the radio and someone didn't know what the track was, but they knew the sound of my voice, they would be able to tell it was me because of the melodies and the structure and the style of the music.
Yes, it's undeniably you, isn't it? But as you said, I mean, you can only really write about experiences you've had, and every part of that journey, that process of songwriting, it's at one given time, isn't it? You know,
it is. If you're going to be real about it, you know, I don't have to sit down and invent little scenarios to write about, you know, a boy meets girl and trucks down the highway on a, you know, in a soft top limousine, you know, whatever it happens to be. I don't have to do that, and I've never really been one for that. So I think maybe as the years go on, and I've tried to describe this as like a diary. You know, you write down your emotions, your feelings, and what's good in your life at that moment, and what's bad in your life at that moment, and you try and put it in a palatable sense, so that it makes some kind of linear sense. Because I believe that someone somewhere will hear one of those tracks and think, you know what, that song's about me. That song's about my life, because that's what I'm going through right now, and that's what music should kind of do to you. It should provoke an emotion. It should make you feel that you've been wrapped in a warm blanket, or it should make you cry, or it should make you happy, or it should make you dance. It should provoke some kind of emotion. And right now we're going through a phase where, if you look at the big artists, a lot of the big artists in the world, and look at the songwriting credits, they're written by a team. They're written by 20 people, you know.
Yes.
So it's like, it's manufactured, it's music by committee.
Yeah.
It's manufactured music to try and make you buy the music, as opposed to listening to one person or one artist, one band's collective ideas.
That is such an interesting way, and so perceptive way of looking at it, but so true. I mean, talking of music that makes you feel something, I mean, Ultravox, Vienna, I just, dancing with tears in your eyes, it just does so much to me. It's fantastic. I mean, it's such a fantastic song, and the video, of course, was inspired by The Third Man. I mean, were you aware you were creating such a cutting-edge look and sound at the time?
We knew we were doing something that was different, just as we knew we were doing something different with the music. You know, there's a wonderful thing that, you know, in hindsight, you can look back and think, what made us go and write something like that? Because it was so odd at the time. It's okay looking back and thinking, well, it was obviously going to be a hit record, Vienna. No, it wasn't. It was the antithesis of what people were listening to at the time. It was too long. It sped up in the middle. It slows down at the end. It's electronic with a viola solo. You know, it just didn't fit any of the format. So when it came to making the videos, you know, we insisted that we actually took out a bank loan to make the video, because the record company wouldn't do it. They didn't see the point. They said, the record's already number two. What's a video going to do? We said, well, you know, we've got this idea, and we shot we got the bank loan, and we shot the video on, you know, 16 millimeter film, not video. We cropped the screen top and bottom to make it look like CinemaScope. You know, with the shadows and the cobbles, we had the, you know, it was black and white. It was very film noir. And it wasn't until after we did that we realized that a lot of that influence would have come from movies like The Third Man. But of course, it changed everything. Once other artists saw that video, they all said, I want one of those, you know, and I need one of those for my record. So it kind of revolutionized how people, you know, perceived music. Up until then, it was something you listened to.
Mm.
And then with videos like that and the advent of things like MTV, it was an audio-visual experience.
Absolutely.
As well.
Yeah, definitely. It was the whole package, really, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
I mean, you've always been such an innovator, and, you know, you've masterminded the great Ultravox, and also a founder of Band Aid and Live 8, with a single that sold 3.7 million, you know, Do They Know It's Christmas. I mean, you've changed the lives of so many children and adults in Africa. I mean, does that song still make you feel proud?
Yeah, I don't see how you can't be proud of it. You know, I've been misquoted many times as saying it was the worst song I've ever written. you know, it's not the best, but it's not. It was an odd song because there is no real chorus to it. That's it was something that was a collaboration that could only happen once. I can't imagine Bob and I ever sitting down and writing anything together again. But it was an odd combination, but a combination that worked. And the song, although it wasn't the greatest song in the world, the record was fabulous because it achieved everything that you've just said. And in a weird way, the song now has gotten better. It seems to have grown up a bit, you know, because it's all embroiled in the, you know, very essence of who we are, what we do.
Yes.
It's such a British thing. It's such a, you know, it's a British record. It's not an American thing. It's just,
no.
It's totally British. It was, you know, it was made in the same vein as, you know, Vienna or, you know, any of the songs from around that, you know, early 80s period.
Yeah.
It was electronic, it was atmospheric, and it had all of those things. So it had a real British stamp to it, and we should all be proud of that.
Definitely. I mean, it really touches your heart, and it's like a little magic moment that just everything just comes together. Everybody's just literally singing from the same song sheet, as they say, but literally just everyone wanted to do that, didn't they?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the weird thing today is that, you know, when you're walking around the supermarket in, you know, September or October, whenever they start playing Christmas records and the record comes on, that opening clang, and the, you know, it's the hair in the back of your neck stands up. It still does its job. It's just incredible.
It's amazing. And like you said, it's interesting in the world of music how one thing leads to another, because I believe you were playing with Ultravox on the show the Tube, and the seeds of the idea came to Bob, and you sort of ran with it from there. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah, I was on the Tube with of course Paula was co-hosting the show with Jules, and you know, Bob and I had known each other for a long time, and we had the conversation on the phone there. He had just seen the first footage shown on BBC television. I hadn't seen the footage at the time, so I was kind of reticent, saying, "Well, yeah, I'm busy, Bob. You know, what do you mean? You know, Ethiopia? You know, I don't quite understand." Of course, you know, within a few hours of talking to him, I saw the same footage, and of course, we met up when I got back to London, and we discussed what we could do, and we figured out nothing. You know, we're not capable of doing anything other than writing a song, other than making a record and trying to get our friends to get involved and try and get a Christmas number one where we could maybe generate £100,000. And then, of course, the rest is, you know, it went on to do, you know, this phenomenal thing.
It's just amazing, isn't it? But like you said, all pooling together, you know, you did such a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, I understand you were also an ambassador for Save the Children. Would you say that work holds a special place for you in your heart as music?
I think it does. You know, there's no doubt that once you've been there and you've been to Africa, and I went out with the first emergency shipment of goods that the Band-Aid money bought, because if Bob or I didn't go, the cameras didn't go, and because there was new news, you know, it was what we were doing was old news at this point, and new news was round the corner. So if we didn't go, the cameras wouldn't go, therefore it wouldn't be in people's faces, therefore the money would stop rolling in. So I went out there, and of course once you've been there and you've tasted it and seen it and experienced it for yourself, it kind of gets in your system, and you can't just walk away from it. You know, our initial thoughts were Band-Aid was going to be a six-month project, and it's 30 years this year. Oh. You know, we're coming up to the 30th anniversary. Mm. And that is just something we didn't foresee at all. Maybe we did. If we had seen that further down the line, we might not have done it. I don't know. But, you know, once you're there and you're involved in it, you cannot walk away from it. So Save the Children have asked me on numerous occasions to go out there and see what some of the investment from the Band-Aid money has actually done, you know, the difference that it's made. Mm. And I was reticent to go, I have to say. I haven't been the first time. I wasn't cut out to experience that. Mm-hmm. And when they approached me about going, I really prevaricated, and they said, no, you'll see a lot of positive stuff.
Oh,
and
good.
I went out and I saw the difference that it made. I met the difference that people putting their hand in their pocket and buying that record had made.
Yeah.
You know, I saw kids who were now, you know, young students and, you know, teachers And, you know, who were in the aid camps back in 1984. So it was a big difference.
Oh, absolutely. It just touches your heart, doesn't it? I mean, it's amazing.
Well, our work pales into total insignificance when you see the people out there who dedicate their lives to making the change. And they're the heroes.
Mm. Yeah, there's a lot of heroes. I mean, talking of